The other side of the formula, this is the amazing thing about it. You think it's really torture and you're really having to create these new ideas and you're like this incredible generator, right? And you have to sit and think and, you know, it's actually much more formulaic than that at both sides. I mean, reviewers are experienced enough that they can identify a common weakness a mile away. I mean, I can review grants now. I can tell you the score of a grant within, you give me that whole grant, I think I can tell you the score and not change it very much within, you know, even within decimals. You're only allowed 1, 2, 3, 4 through 9, but I can tell you with, you know, what the score is going to be within about 0.2. I mean, it's just the errors are predictable. So I'm going to go through the individual criteria, the major ones, not all of them, but the major ones. And even for the mechanisms where these criteria don't show up, these are still being evaluated. So it'll be useful, I hope. So here's some of the strengths that will typically be identified, that it's a critical barrier in the progress of a field. Okay, it's recognizable as something. So you remember yesterday I talked about the idea of putting yourself in this stream of research. So this is the part that says, yeah, you've put yourself in this stream of research and that this project is going to move that process ahead. And that something, you know, something will be advanced. It could be technical capability. It could be clinical practice. Usually it's scientific knowledge. There will be some clear advance if the aims are achieved. Okay? It's great if that can be if either the hypothesis or the null is supported, but, you know, in any case, this is going to make a contribution. Of course, that's good. So the weaknesses, and I've touched on these already, lacking or a weak theoretical framework comes up all the time. People get so close to their own work, and they get so sort of challenged by the technical details and by the really, really difficult minutiae of the experimental design that they never step back and figure out what's the whole theoretical framework for this thing. That has to be in there. It has to be explicit. The aims have to be hypothesis-driven. It's just incredible how often the specific aims read without a hypothesis being anywhere on the page. You know, it's a big, big, big mistake. There has to be a hypothesis that's attached to, or at least suggests, a clear experimental design. The opposite of this is where you have something that's driven by methods. You know, your department chair paid for some really expensive piece of equipment and a bunch of people, and you got to use them, and this is what you know how to do with them, so that's what you're going to do. There are a lot of projects that are like that. Population-driven, you know, I work in this clinic, I have this great clinical data set, and I have access to this incredible population. And then that's the data set looking for a question. People will say that all the time, and it's just disastrous. Motivated by where you are, not what needs to be known, right? Those populations exist. If they're so great, somebody would have gone and asked that maybe. But, I mean, in our field, not necessarily so. There aren't really very many of us. Paucity of information, I should have said. Unclear motivation, poor integration of the existing literature. Really bad if one of your reviewers is a major contributor to that literature and you haven't cited them at all. So there's the gratuitous citation. You want to avoid that, of course, but to ignore somebody who's sort of a major contributor in the area, this is a big problem. So make sure you've covered the literature. And then weak connection to human health. Now, you have to make sure you acknowledge where you are in the continuum, you know, improving human health, okay, to be clear about it. A lot of people just go straight to the PI. Some people review grants, first thing they do is go to the Biosketch, and in study sections, sometimes you'll have people that won't do anything except go open up the grant and go to the Biosketch or the PI. And they'll raise their hand and say, you know, I don't see this person's really published enough. And then the review is over. So you can be very, very, very vulnerable to being weak on publication, weak with respect to your demonstrated expertise, weak in terms of the team. So all of that stuff has to be there. This has to be the best team you can assemble to address this question. People are not really going to give you a big break. That said, what you have to be is appropriate for your career stage. So nobody expects you to have had your Nobel Prize when you're 25. But at 25, you should have a demonstrated trajectory. You know, you have to have been productive or on a trajectory that says you're going to be productive. And you know what that means. You know what, you know, the high achievers in your cohort are doing, right? And so hopefully that's you. That's the metric that you're evaluated on. So a weak publication record, and this shouldn't be too disturbing. If your publication record is weak, there are other ways to get federal funding in your hands. So the question here is whether your publication record is weak relative to the mechanism you're targeting, okay? If you had non-productive postdoc training, if you did a postdoc, you went to the trouble to do a postdoc and you didn't have manuscripts come out of that, that's a little disastrous. I'm not sure, you know, there are different ways to recover from that, but that's a difficult thing. A postdoc is the only time in anyone's career that you have 100% dedicated time for research. So if you're not productive in that opportunity when you're walking into an active, productive lab, there is something seriously wrong, right? So that's actually a really risky spot to be in. You're going to be very productive in all likelihood, but the flip side of that is you better be, you know, really productive in all likelihood. Unproductive prior grant support can be just as devastating. Unpublished dissertation research, I'm not sure why that would happen, but that can happen, and you need to take care of that somehow. Lack of training, so we talked about this. Lack of a formal plan, so that's good. I covered all this stuff. The mentor might be too junior. There are ways to work around that. Just get a really senior, experienced mentor on your team. You can actually have part of the plan be mentoring a mentor. And it's not quite that explicit, but it's sort of obvious in the organization, right, or apparent in the organization. So mentoring a mentor can be a great thing to do. Should be innovative. You know what innovation is. Techniques that are not current or appropriate. Tilted too heavily to description. That's just no theoretical framework, too incremental. And here's the worst one I was trying to get to. So the most painful review I ever did, which is many, many years ago, and I'll never forget it, was an application that was perfectly written. I mean, everything was there. This thing was like a poster child for beautiful grants. Just incredible. Everything. Except the idea was just really so uninteresting. The idea was just fatally uninteresting. It just did not really care how that came out. So, you know, there is an infinite number of questions that could be asked. Most of them shouldn't get anyone's resources, their time, their money, their life energy, you know, shouldn't be put into most of those questions. We could come up with those questions all day. There's a tiny, tiny little number of questions that deserved it to be asked and that fit into the scientific stream, right? So those are the ones that for you to identify. And actually, those are sort of, you know, a lot of them are just sort of on the ground for you to pick up and tweak a little bit so they become more innovative. So methodology is good. I'm going to come up with this one, pitfalls. Let's see. Well, you have to identify pitfalls and strategies for overcoming pitfalls. That's a requirement these days. Reviewers want to know that you've thought enough about the project to recognize where things might go sort of in unintended directions and to anticipate those and to provide remedies before you encounter those problems. And the more of those pitfalls you can anticipate and the stronger your remedies, then the stronger the application looks. Very, very important. So necessarily risky aspects of the experiment are anticipated and managed. Feasibility, I think I mentioned. Overambitious, I'm sure I mentioned. Sample size, you know, using power analysis, using real support values, not just, you know, it's obvious when you come up with 25 subjects and your power analysis has some weird numbers in the you know, effect sizes that get you to 25, you know, that you just ran the process backward, right? So, you know, be real. Show where your real preliminary data come from to, and it can be from existing literature. It doesn't have to be your own data necessarily. Where does the effect size come from? So preliminary hypothetical data. So if you don't have enough time to generate preliminary data, a beautiful thing to do is generate hypothetical data. You can sort of you know, make up a data set and show how you're going to treat that data set. Run it through your analysis and show how this data set is going to inform a theory and show different alternatives. It can be really a beautiful way to do it. You know, you sort of, in chemistry, they call that dry labbing the experiment. You can tell people, you know, I'm going to dry lab this whole experiment. Here's how it would come out. It's beautiful, you know, when it works. Failure to consider remedies. I'm almost done. So first, here's some comments that are very, very common. First two aims have already been completed. That's deadly, right? You're all done. The proposed research appears very unlikely to be completed in the proposed time, so that's overambitious. Too many experiments are proposed. There's no evidence, so this is feasibility, that the applicant can generate this level of productivity. That's also your biosketch, right? You've never published that many experiments in 3 years or whatever. So this is also deadly. The applicant's weak publication record and lack of a dissemination plan suggests that it's unlikely that the proposed research will be published. None of this matters one whit if you don't publish it. The grant is not a product. Hiring people is not a product. Your next grant is not a product. The only product we have in science is your peer-reviewed manuscript. So if you're not anticipating peer-reviewed publication, then you know this is really just wasted effort on everyone's part. Okay, so you should put it in there explicitly. If the work's already been done, especially if it's been done by sesame, bialy, and garlic, and bagels today, provided an unequivocal result, that would be fatal, right, if this work has already been done, unless you're proposing a replication. You've got to demonstrate feasibility, availability of subjects, demonstrated expertise, institutional support. These are all things I covered, right? Enthusiastic things, on the other hand, strong publication record in first author publications, high-impact journals. The composition of the team is strong with highly productive researchers in complementary areas, so they're not all doing the same thing. They all bring something unique to the project. And that everything that's needed by the project is there. Statistics, technical support, analysis. You might need a physicist. So everybody you need is on the team. And it's enhanced by demonstrated logistics. So you've got a logistical plan for meeting and collaborating that's already in place. So you're all set. All you need is the cash, and you trip the trigger, and off you go.